Okay, welcome to the spring semester of lectures. This is going to be an absolutely fantastic series. I'm so pumped up myself about the research that I've been doing over the break since the fall semester. And our basic topic is going to be moving from the Iberian Peninsula, the history of the Jews of Spain and Portugal, to the Sephardic diaspora. So over the course of the next 12 odd weeks, we're going to be exploring what exactly happened to the Sephardim as they left the Iberian Peninsula, and we will, as is our wont, tend to focus on the lives of particular individuals. Tonight, we're going to talk about someone who has received very little attention in the scholarly world, even though there is quite a bit of archival data that can be mined, and only now are scholars beginning to really work with the material that we have, particularly in Italian archives, the life of Benvenida Abravanel. As the name indicates, she is a member of the great Abarbanel Abravanel family. I'll show you her family tree, and there's some interesting sort of difficult skeletons buried there that we'll explore, but she's exemplary in so many ways of the new identity that Sephardim began to develop as they entered the first century of their diaspora. Some fascinating things I hope to share with you. Global ideas like, in many ways, they really constituted the first diaspora community since the exile of the Jews from Israel in the first century. And they were able to become an international community far more than any prior diaspora, as we shall see. And in many ways, their activity articulated the notion of a world Jewish community more than anyone prior. Well, I'm also very grateful to be able to speak about her because it's so hard to find women with enough historical material to actually fill a sophisticated or even, you know, popular lecture such as this. But we do have quite a bit of material on Benvenida Abravanel, and I look forward to sharing with you the aspects of her life and especially the gendered aspects of her life. Let's do the good and welfare materials before we get too far. As I mentioned, the series is going to focus for the rest of the semester on the Sephardim as they fled the Iberian Peninsula. As you can see, these beautiful arrows showing them traveling to Northern Europe, to the entire Mediterranean basin and the Eastern Mediterranean, the Ottoman Empire, and also out to the New World, to America. We'll look at the crypto-Jews as well. I'm also hoping to discuss the experience of the Holocaust by Sephardim that is also, as I wrote in one article a long time ago, an occluded history because so few scholars have really studied Sephardim as opposed to Ashkenazim, even though Sephardim were heavily affected by the Holocaust as well, particularly in Greece. Tonight's lecture is sponsored by Dr. Karen and Michael Marcus in memory of their parents, Harry and Ann Chait, and Isaac and Bertha Marcus. We're very grateful for the sponsorships. Your presence here tonight is sponsorship enough, and it makes me feel very proud that so many of you come out to hear these lectures. And for all of you on the internet, we're hitting about 2,000 views a day, which is kind of an impressive number, I think. We're really grateful for your participation as well. If you would like to support this series specifically, we're engaged in this project primarily to raise funds for student scholarships. We've raised $12,000 so far. I have a goal of $100,000, so we're almost there. And the website is bit.ly/ the Friends of Jewish History. We have 5 lectures this semester that have yet to be sponsored. They're $250 each for a sponsorship. That's a really nice way to participate. But I also really appreciate getting smaller donations too. They all go into the same pot. Even the pushka from my desk goes into this pot, and it helps out our students. Okay, in terms of the sources that we'll use for tonight's lecture, I'm going to rely on 3 sources in particular. I like to give some propers to those who help us out with the background material here. First of all, working with, and there's no monograph length study that I am familiar with yet in any language on the life of Benvenida Abravanel, but so we have a few chapter-length studies. Professor Howard Svi Edelman, a landsman of mine from Canada at Queen's University, wrote a fascinating article on her that is in the Jewish Women's Archive. We'll also rely on Professor Renata Segre's article on the Mendes and Benvenista families in Ferrara, fascinating story of their rivalry that we'll explore. Unfortunately, I couldn't find a picture of her. And Professor David Malkiel wrote an amazing article that will occupy the latter third of this lecture when we look at the remarkable will of Benvenida Abravanel's husband, Shmuel, which occasioned an international debate over what exactly to do with issues of women's inheritance rights, the customs of the secular world as opposed to Jewish halakha, and so on. That's his research. And finally, I have to say that, you know, I don't do this often enough, but I rely very heavily on the phenomenal Turo library staff. They're incredibly professional, incredibly swift and helpful. I have to say that the nicest people in the world end up becoming librarians because all they want to do is help you. They're just so happy you come into the library. They say, well, how can we get you the information you need? In particular, I was desperate for one article that I didn't have, and it was shortly before this lecture, and the amazing Carol Shapiro, indicated here in the Manhattan campus, got it for me in the blink of an eye, and I'm very grateful to her and to all of the Turo library staff, particularly in the basement of Avenue J. Okay, so that's the quick good and welfare. One last detail I've decided to change a little bit for this semester. You know, for a long time I used to tell a joke at the beginning of every class, and I thought that went great. I really enjoyed it. Then for a while, people complained on the internet, so I stopped telling jokes. And then people complained on the internet, hey, where's the jokes? And then most recently, the complaints I'm getting on the internet is, you know, you have to realize I've been giving these lectures for like 5 years. So there's quite a few, several hundred lectures on the web. And people complain saying, wait a minute, you told that joke already. I mean, how many jokes can I possibly know? So anyways, this is what I'm going to try to do this semester. I'm going to only try tell jokes for the first time, meaning I've never told these jokes before. It usually takes me about 4 or 5 tellings before I get it right, but you're going to suffer through the first time. So here's the joke, and then we'll get started. David has led a really profligate life. He has visited houses of ill repute. He has cheated others. He has been incredibly disrespectful of the Sabbath and the holidays, and generally lived a life of wastefulness and wanton behavior. And he's on his deathbed, and the rabbi comes to him, says to him, David, you know, after this long life and all of the mistakes you've made and all the bad choices you made and how you transgressed the Torah in so many ways, now is the time that you should denounce your Yetzer Hara, your evil inclination. You should denounce the Satan. You should denounce Satan who tempted you into all of these evil ways. Now is the time to make your stand and say what you really believe in. Are you prepared to denounce the Yetzer Hara and the Satan? And David says, Rabbi, until I know where I'm going, I don't think it's so wise to do that. Okay, not so funny, but like I said, first time I'm telling it. Okay, thank you for the shrug. Okay, let's go on. Let's talk history. So the Abravanel dynasty, we spent quite a bit of time talking about Don Isaac Abravanel. So let's place Benvenida, sometimes spelled, by the way, Benvenuta, in this context. So here is Don Isaac, Yitzchak Abravanel or Abarbanel, who was, of course, the great leader of the Jewish people in Spain and Portugal, went on to Venice and many other places as well. He was originally of Spanish roots, but as you recall, we discussed in the class a few weeks ago, his father was forcibly converted, possibly in the end of the 14th century, as indicated here. He then, a few decades later, he fled to Portugal and readopted his Jewish identity and recanted his forced conversion. And there he raised his family. Judah was his son, and Judah had several sons, one of which was named Don Isaac. Yitzchak, Don Isaac Abravanel, had a son named Samuel, and his brother, Jacob, had a daughter named Benvenida. We don't have her birth date, but it would be reasonable to assume that she was probably born somewhere around 1490 or 1500. And the two of them married. So they're first cousins marrying. The laws of consanguinity, I think that's how you pronounce that word, the laws of blood relations are somewhat more flexible in traditional Judaism, although not nearly practiced so widely. At any rate, she comes from the Abravanel side through both her father and through her father-in-law and husband Samuel. So that's where she fits within the overall family. She had several children, Letitia, Judah, Yaakov, and Gioia, and there's more to this story that we'll reach later. She lived her life outside of Spain, of course, because the expulsion occurred in 1492, and most of this story occurs right in the beginning of the Portuguese and Spanish diaspora. So I'd like to just pause for a second and think about that for a minute. I've mentioned Spain and Portugal several times in the last few sentences because, you have Shmuel who migrates from Spain into Portugal, then you have his grandson Isaac migrates from Portugal into Spain, and then they're of course expelled. What is the whole business of Spanish and Portuguese Jews? And you'll see quite often that they're mentioned in the same breath when you speak about the diaspora. What is the big deal about Portugal? The obvious point is, of course, that so many Jews fled from the expulsion of 1492 into Portugal, but you know, they were only there for a few decades at most, stretching into the 16th century and slowly making their way out of there. How long does it take before you adopt the identity of the neighboring country? Here you have, for example, from the website of the Congregation Charis Israel here in New York, the Spanish and Portuguese synagogue. And as the website indicates, it was started by 23 Jews in 1654. And for only 23 Jews, do they really have to have Spanish and Portuguese? I mean, couldn't they get away with Spanish or even Iberian? I mean, why do they have to specifically designate Spanish and Portuguese? So I would like to prefer as a possibility that definitely has some historical validity, but it's a little bit of a chidush, a little bit of an insight that I had. We should recall that there is a key difference between the way in which Spanish Jews, by and large, were able to integrate into larger society and Portuguese Jews. Why is that so? We should remember the way that the Inquisition and the expulsions worked. The Inquisition was not per se directed at Jews. The Inquisition, you'll recall, was directed at Jews who had converted forcibly or otherwise and were secretly Judaizing or were suspected of Judaizing. In other words, you have, like, let's say, a massive forced conversion of Jews in 1391, and all of a sudden you have several generations of Christians who have full access to everything that Spain has to offer, no more legal restrictions, but on the other hand, they only marry other converted Christians. They insist on going back to buy food for Passover, going back to synagogue to get lessons in Hebrew, and their Christianity is questioned by the church, leading ultimately to the institution of the Inquisition, which specifically inquired into the bona fides, literally the good faith, of their Christianity. So the Inquisition per se targeted these so-called new Christians. The expulsion, on the other hand, of 1492 was directed at Jews, not the new Christians. The Jews were expelled because, as was argued in the writ of expulsion, they were expelled because they were they exerted a gravitational pull on the new Christians. That so long as the Jews maintained their own distinct polity within the Iberian Peninsula, the new Christians would always be going back to them, would always be getting more religious training from them, and you could never be sure of their Christian faith. And so therefore, in 1492, it was the Jews who were expelled. The new Christians, technically, could stay. Let me get to the Portuguese point, then I'll pause for a question. So when the Jews were expelled, the first place that they went, of course, was Portugal. This is the easiest crossing. It involves no major cultural shift. They don't have to move into Arab, Muslim, North Africa. They don't have to move out of Spanish-speaking Spain into France, for example. They certainly don't have to make the dangerous sea voyages out here where they may not be accepted in any of the ports they visit. And forget about going to New York or any place like that. New York at this point is so backward, there's not a single Chinese restaurant anywhere in Manhattan. So Portugal absorbed a lot of these Jews. Now, we are not going to go into the details of the Portuguese experience today because I've scheduled it more for next week, but we should understand that the Portuguese experience was very, very different. There, the kings were not necessarily so, you know, rabidly doctrinal about their pursuit of Christian ideological purity. They were prepared to tolerate a lot more open hypocrisy in order to keep the Jews within their boundaries. And they were willing to engage in all kinds of stratagems to keep Jewish wealth in Portugal and simply turn a blind eye to their poor observance of Christianity. So you had in Portugal a lot more of these new Christians, a lot more Jews who had converted for reasons that we'll discuss in much greater detail, God willing, next week. When they also were forced out of Portugal, 1497 and later, then you had two distinct populations in the Mediterranean basin. You had Spaniards, Sephardic Jewry per se, who were the old Jews, who had never converted, and you had the Portuguese new Christians who were returning to their Jewish roots, but technically were freed from the shackles of Jewish religious identity and legal disabilities. And the two groups had a very different access and entree to European culture, to European laws and society, as we shall explore. One of the great rivalries that we'll talk about today is between the Abravanels, who were Sephardim, who had never converted, and the Mendes family from Doña Gracia Mendes, who was one of the Portuguese who had converted and was returning. By the way, in terms of the Portuguese pressure placed on Jews, some tremendously horrible things, and we will go into greater detail next week, but I wanted to mention one of the worst is the exile of Jewish children, separating them from their parents and sending them from Portugal, you can see on the west coast of Europe there, down to the islands, the Portuguese islands of São Tomé here off the coast of West Africa. Absolutely horrific conditions. We'll talk about it more next week. The Mendes family here, this is actually the niece of Gracia Mendes, not Gracia herself, were from that Portuguese stock, and they had in many ways a lot more rights and privileges because they technically were converted Christians. And for typically economic reasons, the local ruling powers were prepared to turn a blind eye to their personal domestic practice if they stayed within their environs and contributed to the economic climate of society. Okay, so that's where the Abravanels fit. They are the old Jews, the Sephardim per se, who not the Portuguese. And we'll probably explore this dichotomy more in later weeks as well. So let's look a little bit specifically at her life. We know most about her life in the period between Naples and Ferrara. Anyways, here is the map of Italy, and the Abravanels ended up here in Naples, where they lived for quite some time. The husband, Samuel, Shmuel, was referred to in local municipal documents, non-Jewish documents, as the king of the Jews. Now, obviously, the Jews did not have a king at this time, but this was probably referring to his high social standing and his great wealth that he was able to leverage to support the Jews of his community. The conflict between the church and the state was extensive during the 16th century. Reformation, counter-reformation was going on, and depending on which power held sway at one particular location or another, there was a various degrees of pressure exerted on the Jewish communities, and specifically those Portuguese Jews who were expected to behave like good Christians whenever the church held more power, as we shall see in Ancona. So there were several expulsions of Jews from Naples. The Abravanels were able to avoid two of those, the first in 1511, most likely by paying a large bribe to the local officials. Again, a second exile was decreed upon the Jews in 1533. I know it's a good question. If they were exiled in 1511, how come there are Jews back in 1533 that you have to exile them? This is one of these ongoing patterns in Jewish history that, you know, when Jews are expelled from a particular region, typically the economy slides, and then Jews are invited back, formally or otherwise, to contribute to the economy, and then, you know, the whole cycle starts again, you know, as we've seen. So the second expulsion in 1533 was most likely averted through Benvenida herself because of her association with Eleonora of Toledo. This is not a picture of Benvenida herself. I put it at the front because I think it's an absolutely beautiful portrait. It's one of the most stunning 16th century portraits you'll find. It's probably one of the first portraits of a noblewoman and her heir in a portrait like this. It's by Il Bronzino. Very beautiful, kind of arresting figure. Anyways, Eleonora was a ward, a non-Jewish woman of the Medici family. She was a ward in Benvenida's home, and she was tutored by Benvenida. She was actually raised in their home, placed there by their family in order to receive some of Benvenida's erudition and her sense of etiquette and style and so on. So we only know about this kind of secondhand, but the fact that a non-Jewish young girl from a very important family was placed within the Abravanel's family to be raised, it gives us some indication of that, what their standing must have been like. As she grew up, when the expulsion of 1533 was ordered, her personal intervention, Eleonora here, made a significant difference in allowing the Abravanels to evade that expulsion as well. The joke that I had right here is I was going to say that, you know, you might think it's unfair that I should put a picture of Benvenida's student up there, but the reality is that, you know, when you really become close with a student, professors actually tend to take on a little bit of their physical likeness, for example, and then I had pictures of Brad Pitt and Tom Cruise, and I was going to say these are some of my former students, George Clooney, one of my graduate students. Such a waste. Okay, anyways, so that gives you a sense of how powerful it was. But she could not avoid it forever, and in 1541, a third exile was declared, and in fact, they moved to Ferrara, which is in the north of Italy. You can see it up over here. It turned out to be a very important center for Jewish activity in Italy, primarily because of a new technology that had become quite the rage among Jews, and that is the technology of printing. Benvenida was one of the primary sponsors of print scholarship. And I would love to spend a lot more time talking about this revolutionary aspect of the 16th century in the Jewish world, but I'll just hold myself to maybe a couple of minutes. We should realize that the evolution of print technology made a massive difference for Jews that we're still feeling today. And in fact, we feel many echoes of it today with the institution of the internet, which some of you may have heard of. The idea that you could mass produce at a reasonable price printed documents led to a literacy explosion among Jews. who already prided themselves on having a higher level of literacy than the surrounding society, but all of a sudden you could circulate a tremendous amount of ideas very widely. I mean, we're talking about a period when you have the seam between handwritten, hugely expensive manuscripts of the Talmud and commentaries and so on, to all of a sudden having just about anybody able to actually, it's the equivalent of publishing a blog, that you could write something, you could get it out there quickly, cheaply, and so many people could access ideas. Not all societies accepted the printing revolution. The Muslims, for example, in Turkey, the Ottoman Turks, they felt that printing was such an ugly and cheap, poor imitation of the beauty of handcrafted calligraphy that they waited about 100 years before they really got on the ball with printing, not recognizing it for the technological advantage that it gave a society. But Jews were early adopters of printing. Many of the early printed works we have in general are written in Hebrew. This is the era of the first printing of the Talmud, for example, and so on. Really an incredible thing. So she was at the center of that new printing world. Ferrara was a noted location for printing. One of the first and most important books that she contributed to, which was actually dedicated to her rival, Gracia Mendez, because she gave apparently even more money, was this book that we'll study next week, The Consolation for the Tribulations of Israel, which was a Portuguese work that was written by Rabbi Samuel Usque as an attempt to explain the earth-shattering significance of the Spanish expulsion. That will be our topic for next week. But you can see that this is the frontispiece, and you can see the globe. The idea that here the Jews are now once again a diaspora people after living for over 1,000 years in Spain, suddenly they're wandering around the globe, and the Latin phrase here on the banner is "In God is my hope." It's a fascinating work that we'll discuss next week. So that's one of the major contributions she made, was using her wealth to sponsor scholarship. She also used her wealth for one of the other unfortunate aspects of the sudden diaspora from the peninsula. She used a lot of it to ransom captives. This is a period when human trafficking was booming. You have lots of stateless peoples who are wandering around the Mediterranean basins. We're not speaking only about, of course, the rise of the transatlantic African slave trade, which will really explode in the 16th century once the Portuguese open up West Africa. But there are a lot of Jews who are captured, and it's widely known throughout Europe that Jews will redeem their own. Jews will pay the ransom to get their own back. Benvenida is actually reputed to have ransomed over 1,000 slaves. She was able to 1,000 Jews who were taken into captivity. This, by the way, is unfortunately a modern prayer for contemporary captives, referring to those Israeli soldiers who unfortunately are captured in war and are held hostage for various negotiations. So it's still something that we have today, unfortunately, but in Benvenida's time, she really used her wealth quite liberally for the mitzvah of Pidyon Shvuyim, of rescuing and redeeming captives. These are the kinds of things that she was doing there. One other thing was really quite unusual and consequential for world Jewry at the time, and Benvenida was very caught up on it, and that is the episode surrounding an unusual and mysterious figure known as David Reuveni. Probably born around the year 1500, died around 1550. We believe his death is kind of a mystery. He was sent to prison ultimately in Portugal, and there he disappeared. Reuveni was a small man. Some of the references speak of him as a dwarf with a very dark skin, perhaps of African origins. And there have been a lot of suppositions. Perhaps he came from Afghanistan. Perhaps he came from part of Africa. Still not clear. But he strode widely across the global stage in Europe, visiting the courts of many kings and popes, and presented this amazing messianic model of a global conflict that he would engineer to bring about the coming of the Messiah. Specifically, he alluded to the mysterious kingdom of Prester John, which was a medieval concept that many Christians believed that there was a massive army, possibly of Jews, they were called the Red Jews, living inside a mountain in the Caucasus region. And at some point in the war of Gog and Magog, all of these Jews would come spilling out of this mountain, and you would have this great conflagration that would ultimately end up in Armageddon and the coming of the Messiah. So Reubeni went from court to court saying that he had the ear of Prester John himself, and that with the right inducements, he needed a little bit more reinforcements from European armies, he would actually take that huge host from the Caucasus Mountains, and they would invade the Ottoman Turkish Empire, and they would liberate Israel from its Muslim controllers, and this was something which was seen with great enthusiasm by his Christian interlocutors. He actually held audiences with many kings and popes who took him seriously, and Benvenida Abravanel also, she supported him financially. She supported him with this amazing banner that you can see represented in this piece of art here. Oops, doesn't zoom in there. In which it has the Ten Commandments emblazoned on it, and he made kind of like a striking figure, wandering with tremendous chutzpah into all of these courts and claiming this. When he met with the Pope, or perhaps it was Charles V, the Holy Roman Emperor, he said, "You know what? I think you should go to my relative, King João of Portugal." I love saying that name. I know I'm saying it wrong, but I like saying João. So go to him, and he'll help you out. He went to Portugal. Again, a chutzpah, right? This is after the Jews have been expelled and are excoriated. He goes to King João, and King João goes for it. He says, "You know what? This is great. I'm definitely going to chip in. You can count on me." And while he's there, he meets a young new Christian named Diogo Pires, who was a young man who, again, this is one of these people who was converted to Christianity forcibly. He may have been the child of parents who were converted to Christianity. And he saw in David Reubeni this glimpse of a messianic future, and he became immediately a Baal Tshuva. He immediately said, "I want to follow this man. I want to get close to God through my Jewish roots," and so on. He circumcised himself. Ouch. And that he followed, he became Reubeni's right-hand man and proclaimed his presence wherever they went. They actually later had a falling out, the two of them, and Shlomo Molcho, that was the name that he took on from his Christian name. He became Shlomo Molcho, which means call me Solomon King. It's a little bit of a variation on the pronunciation. This is actually his signature, highly stylized signature that seems to, in itself, herald the arrival of the Messiah. He went to the Pope, where, because he was a Christian who had returned to Judaism, he did not survive the Inquisition and was burned at the stake. David Reubeni spent a few months in Portugal, and then suddenly King João thought he wasn't so amazing and ended up jailing him, and he most likely died in jail. But this is kind of an interesting interlude in Benvenida's life, in that she supported this messianic pretender who had for a brief period of time the attention of world Jewry and even the leaders of the world as a whole. One more item that gives you a sense of Benvenida's global position, the Ancona affair of 1555. Ancona is a port city located here on the western coast of Italy. And Jews were not allowed to live there, but they were tolerated because of their association with the with trade. They were, you know, it was an extremely important port, and there's a lot of trade going through that particular city. The Pope Paul IV took over the region in part of a conflict between local powers, and he immediately arrested some 50 of these Portuguese Jews who were, again, they were technically Christians who had returned to their Jewish identity after escaping the Iberian Peninsula. And he ultimately, through the Inquisition, burned 25 of those Jews at the stake. So Gracia Mendes, who was furious, you recall that she was a very important and powerful woman as well, who was of the Portuguese extraction. She was furious, and she argued for a very strong response of world Jewry. This was rather unprecedented, if you think of it, in the 16th century for someone to be suggesting this. She argued that the entire port of Ancona should be boycotted, that Jews should no longer use Ancona as a port, and they would cripple it economically. Mendes herself was extremely wealthy, had tremendous connections in Istanbul and in the Turkish Empire, and as a result, her point of view had a tremendous amount of economic and political clout behind it. Benvenida, on the other hand, disagreed and said that, you know, if they were to antagonize the papal states by boycotting Ancona, then it would only reflect more poorly on Jews elsewhere. Furthermore, it did not need to be pointed out at the time, Mendes herself would have profited tremendously by diverting trade away from Ancona to some of the ports that she had more interest in, whereas Abravanel had much more interest in Ancona itself. After a few years of significant internal Jewish controversy, it died down and Ancona remained open. The boycott did not take hold, it did not have permanence, and it certainly did not move Pope Paul IV to change his positions whatsoever. But just the very chutzpah that a Jew should suggest a international boycott of a port, and let alone not only a Jew, a woman should suggest a boycott of a port, gives you some sense of how much these women were giants of the 16th century, and how they clashed with each other over some very significant elements. Now, the last part of this story is one that it's going to be hard to tell well. I'll do my best to try and give it over, but we actually have quite a bit of archival evidence to back up this part of Benvenida's story. You will recall that in many of our discussions in the past, a lot of Jewish history is reconstructed from the responsa literature, shelot u'tshuvot in Hebrew. This is when there's some kind of legal dispute or a question about practice or about changing social mores and a question seeking guidance on how Jews are to react to those changing mores. And the answers that the rabbis give back say a lot. Besides the theological and halachic Jewish legal information, they tend to say a lot about the nature of the social fabric of the historical period. So for a long time, we have possessed significant responsa literature about a very notorious dispute over a will that occurred in Ferrara in the 16th century, but it's only in recent years that it has been connected specifically with Benvenida Abravanel. And David Malkiel has published a major 60-page article that identifies all of the archival sources that points it specifically to her. So we know that the story of this controversial will is in fact associated with her and her family. And it's a sad story. And by the way, it makes me think of my father, Olive Shalom, who always used to tell me that whenever there is a will, there is going to be family dispute, that children fight over the inheritance. That never happened when my father, Olive Shalom, passed away, but only because I'm an only child. And who else am I going to fight with? But Anyways, here's the story. Samuel, the husband of Benvenida, some years after the exile from Naples to Ferrara, had to go on a long journey. And he apparently at that time composed a will. Then several years later, while he was being treated for an illness, he was ultimately killed by a medicine that was prescribed to him by a local doctor. May have been malpractice, perhaps it was an allergy, who knows. But at any rate, Samuel dies, I believe the year is 1550. And there is immediately a dispute over the disposition of his property. Now, you would think that it should be fairly straightforward. Jewish law tends to give priority to the firstborn male child. There are firstborn male children here. There are survivors. What's the problem? The main problem is that Samuel had a child from a previous relationship, and his name was Isaac. Now, we don't know. It's not entirely clear how Isaac came to be. The sources are vague, the Jewish sources at any rate. The Italian sources referred to him as naturale e bastardo, which I think you can anticipate what that might mean, but like as a natural son. It could have come from a prior marriage of which we are ignorant. But anyways, the firstborn male was this son Isaac, who was only a half-sibling to the later children who was born to Benvenida. Now, Isaac, upon the death of his father, claimed assets. And Isaac, by the way, was known to Benvenida. It was not a secret. He did not live with the family. He was an adult at this time. And he claimed his share, which according to traditional biblical law would be pishnayim, which would be twice the size of his younger brother's shares. However, another very well respected principle in Jewish law is hamotzi michavero alav lahevi araya. If you want to take property that is in the possession of someone else, the onus is on you to provide proof that you should get this. So there was a dispute, and 3 years after Shmuel Abravanel dies, Benvenida produces the will. So one of the big questions is, why did she wait 3 years to produce this will? She said it's because it had lots of embarrassing things in it, and it did. The will itself is a very unusual document in many ways. We're going to explore two specific ways in a second. But one of the things it says is that the heir to Shmuel's property is not Isaac and is not his son Judah. It's Benvenida. He leaves his property to his wife as his heir. And that is highly unusual in Jewish law. Typically, the firstborn son receives more, the other sons receive the balance, and the mother is expected to be supported by these sons. This is, when you read the Torah and you imagine kind of like the Middle Eastern ancient setting, you always imagine, I shouldn't say always, but predominantly women live in the shadow of men, either in the shadow of their protective father, their protective husband, or in this case, their protective sons. There's a lot of fascinating discussion in halacha on what does it mean now that women have economic independence, what does that mean for many of these issues? And it came to play here as well. And not only was Benvenida named the heir of all this property, she was the executrix, meaning she could decide when and how much to give to each of the sons. There was an indication that they should receive part of that wealth, but it depended on how they behaved and who they married. Did they marry women that Benvenida approved of? And there was a lot of like conditions attached to this will that was revealed, again, 3 years after the death. So this, because of the massive amount of money that's associated with this will, you imagine this is not just some shtetl will. We're talking about, you know, a Reichman kind of will, a Bill Gates-sized will. And maybe I should say, who else? Who's a rich Jewish guy? Okay, there he goes. I don't know. Let's go on. I don't want to think about that. Jared Kushner will ikves a big amount of money. So it immediately became an international cause celebre that attracted the solicited and unsolicited opinions of rabbis all over the world, including the opinion of the great Maharam Mipadua. Rav Yosef Karo was cited very heavily, very important rabbis who were really the leading figures of their day. What were the major elements of controversy? There are two elements of it, both of which are striking and have tremendous implications for Jewish law. The first is the will almost totally ignores Jewish law. The will gives the money to the wife. And while there's kind of like a token where he says regarding his son Isaac, he should get some special jewels that are precious and valuable, it doesn't give him the pishnayim that the Torah refers to, the double half. Now, this is not totally outside of what can be expected, because there is a very well-known phenomenon that in order to find a way to distribute one's wealth before death, there is this halakhic institution called the matana mechayim, a gift while alive, where a person can say, listen, I have $100,000. I would like to make sure that all of my 10 kids get it equally, so I'm giving it to them right now while I'm alive, each $10,000. And then whatever's left after I die will go according to traditional inheritance law. So it's not completely unheard of. But the law basically flouted, the will basically flouted that aspect of it and did not really even bring it into any serious consideration. And secondly, also more difficult, they didn't do it with two kosher witnesses, which would be the standard Jewish practice of executing a will. They went to a notary. And this, a non-Jewish notary, which was like, oh my gosh, how can you disperse so much wealth by using a non-Jewish authority to bring this about? And this was a huge amount of argument. Should the will be invalidated, A, because it ignored the traditional halakhic boundaries, and B, because it used a non-Jewish system of recording the will? So one of the reasons why there was a hava amina, there was a thought that perhaps the will would still be valid, is because there was this enshrined principle that is quite complicated and is often tested in Jewish law of dina demalchuta dina. The law of the land is the law. In other words, even though Jewish law requires a will to be written in such and such a manner, if you do it according to a non-Jewish form, since that is what is accepted in the state, then perhaps it should be acceptable. And in fact, the rabbis who opined on this issue split, with some of the very prominent rabbis saying it should be, the will should be set aside, and others saying the will should be upholded. In the end, after a protracted legal debate, both sides agreed to arbitration. And Isaac, in his depositions on the fair, said that he felt badly about going to arbitration, but he was broke and he could not support himself and his family while engaging in a massive extended lawsuit with his stepmother over this will. He may end up winning in the end, but he simply could not afford the lawsuit. And so as a result, they went to arbitration and the will was divided accordingly as per the will of Shmuel Abravanel. One more detail that I think is quite fascinating here, since there's a lot of depositions involved and a lot of swearing is going on at this time, it's fascinating to see how Jews took the oath. I mean, if they were Jews per se, then they typically took the oath on some kind of Torah scroll, or at least a printed chumash, which were available at this time. If they were Portuguese new Christians, then sometimes, even though they were Jews, they would take the oath on a traditional Bible that a Christian would use as well. And it's fascinating to see the whole range of adaptations that Jews were making to society at that time. So that's the last story we have about Benvenida. Let's just think a little bit about her legacy in this context. So what we begin to see in the period of the life of Benvenida Abravanel, and we will explore it more as we move through the 16th century, is that ironically, by expelling its Jews and then later by expelling its new Christian heretics, meaning these crypto-Jews, these Portuguese Jews, the Iberian Peninsula released upon the world an unusual new diaspora, perhaps entirely unprecedented in its nature and scope, in that these were Jews who, first of all, had a strong connection to each other over a broad swath of international territory, were located in many different countries to a degree that we never had before, as Jews tended to use, if we can use the phrase, chain migration, where they tended to, you know, make small incremental moves across the coast of North Africa or up the Italian peninsula. All of a sudden, they're scattered. Literally, the word in Greek, diaspora, means scattering. They're scattered across the Mediterranean, and they constitute one community. They constitute one nation. This is something which is fairly unprecedented in European history and certainly in Jewish history. Furthermore, because of the strange nuanced shading of the Portuguese Jews, that is, those Jews who, as baptized Christians, were technically freed from legal restrictions, and if they could find themselves in a home where there was a sufficiently tolerant climate, they could nevertheless practice Judaism, Jews tended to exploit that dual identity for their economic and political and legal benefit. So this created a very unusual, powerful minority that began to coalesce under this identity of Sfaradim, and perhaps helps to understand the long-lasting and secure notion that Sfaradim have of their joint group identity. I hope that you found this lecture interesting and enjoyable. I know I had fun, maybe except for that joke part. Next week, as I mentioned, we're going to focus in on Samuel Usque and his horrible personal experience in the Portuguese expulsion and his explanation for it in a remarkable work which was translated into English only in the 1970s. Thank you for your attention and your endurance. I hope you enjoyed that presentation. I myself got a lot of pleasure doing the research for it, and I think it's wonderful to be back in the spring semester when we talk about the Sephardic diaspora. Just want to share one thought that has really been staying with me for the last little while, and that's, you know, if my supposition that the use of the term Portuguese has an unusually pointed character to it, specifically that the term Spanish in the 15th, 16th century, referred to the Jews, the old Jews who had not converted, and the term Portuguese was kind of an allusion to those Jews who had been forcibly converted and then in diaspora were reclaiming their Jewish identity and were attempting to come back to the fold, as it were. If that is true, if that's the way that that term was used, then I think it's so beautiful that you see the use of Spanish and Portuguese together in things like the synagogue here in New York City, the oldest synagogue in the area. Maybe what the meaning of that phrase is, and I could be totally wrong, but maybe the meaning of that phrase is that we embrace you, we welcome you, that don't worry about the past, it was a difficult time, we understand horrible persecutions, you know, but you're fundamentally part of the Jewish people and we want to include you in our congregation. I mean, if that's the intention of that strange phrase, Spanish and Portuguese synagogue, etc., I think it's a very, very beautiful concept and sentiment. Anyways, that's it. Next week, I'm really looking forward to speaking about the Portuguese diaspora in greater detail, and I look forward to speaking with you then. Take care and have an excellent week.